Hello dear students, welcome to EPG Paathshala. I am Dr. Savita Kaushal from NUPA Delhi. This module is on basic tenets of qualitative research. Objectives of this module are introduction to philosophical terms in context of qualitative research, describe the focus of the qualitative research, and also discuss the assumptions for qualitative research. As you know, in this age of virtual societies, research has become a challenging task for a social scientist. Where are the solutions, answers, controls, and regulatory mechanisms? Let us see. Phenomenology, triangulation, ethnography, and grounded theories all are frequently used, but with little return. Our problems are multiplying and escalating. There are also many perspectives or schools of thought which interpret reality in different ways, namely empiricism, Marxism, phenomenology, naturalistic inquiry, ethnomedology, scientific relativism, symbolic interactionism, feminism, and also structuralism. There are various philosophical terms emerging in the context of qualitative research to realize better existence and living. There are various propositions, doctrines, and principles of qualitative research. Let us begin with survey, the most common tool of social analysis. Useful as they are, though surveys face a host of interpretive problems. The positive outlook of researchers is based on several basic tenets. First, the objectivity postulate. The reality is that the survey tries to investigate would exist out there and would have a reality independent from the way in which the individuals perceive them. A second tenet of the positivistic outlook on the surveys would be the transparency postulate. But the search for a perfect, unambiguous, referentially transparent, pure denotational language is one of the characteristic longing of the positivist frame of mind. The third positivist tenet would be the generality postulate. The unequivocal meaning of the words and expressions involved in the research process. As a general rule, the more alien the subject of research are regarding the social ontology that the researcher represents, the more likely it is that their answers appear as anomalous and also inconsistent. Similarly, the wider the sociological scope of the survey, the higher its semantic diversity is likely to be, and less the equivalence principle will work. A measure of socio-semantic distance between the items of a questionnaire may help solve the problem to a reasonable extent. Even in the mega research projects, the field investigators and project assistants are very often neither fully qualified nor properly paid. So, is the status of the reality perceived? The raw data are very often more substantive and revealing than the process data, because in the absence of proper analysis, the essence is lost. In experimental research, largely the scholars move from induction to adduction, to thesis to analogy, to the facts to theories, but inconsistent, scattered researchers lead us nowhere. Social laboratory is a myth and figment of imagination. It has become essential to sustain social life that the social scientists evolve their own methods. In the case study, research diagnosis of a case is important as a prognosis of its disposition, but a large majority of us have become excellent in describing the problems and cases, but we have become solution blind. Here the presage, process, and product variables all need to be treated very carefully. Naturalistic inquiry, which phenomenology demands, needs to be conducted in an open, naturalistic, parametric setting. Because more and more are the controls in a social science laboratory, lesser and lesser is the generalization. the social science research can be better localized than universalized. Qualitative research cannot be conducted through a priori samples only. Sampling goes on throughout the research through various sampling techniques such as typical case sampling, intensity sampling, critical case sampling, sensitive case sampling, convenience sampling, primary selection and secondary selection. Qualitative research cannot be conducted through static tools and techniques because very often the researcher employing qualitative research methodology does not have a sound theoretical base related to the reality. Theory, in fact, is the product of inquiry. Qualitative research is also affected by a wonderful interaction of subject and object. The object needs to be perceived as objectively and comprehensively as feasible. One of the basic tenets of qualitative research is awareness of one's own biases. There is a need to address diversity issues such as gender, race, religion, ability, sexual orientation, and also socioeconomic status. The pursuit of knowledge should be conducted with sincerity and care. Critical theory takes as a central concern the issue of power in the knowledge context. It focuses on how and in whose interest knowledge is produced and passed on. Now, where are the funds floated? What is the interest? What is the return on investment? These are the basic questions which come to our mind. Now, let us see what is the focus of research, qualitative research is on. Qualitative research can focus on several aspects such as biography, phenomenology, grounded theory, ethnography, case study, anthropology, exploratory research, consultative research, community-based participatory research, and also service learning. In biographical studies, the investigator begins with an objective set of experiences in the subject's life, noting life course, stages, and also experiences. For phenomenology, the investigator requires a solid grounding in the philosophical precepts of phenomenology, a careful selection of people who have or are observing the phenomena has to be made. Instead of proceeding with a preconceived theory and a set of hypotheses, grounded theory tries to study a phenomena and a set of data in the context through which the theory emerges. The phrase grounded theory refers to theory that is developed inductively from a corpus of data. If done well, this means that the resulting theory at least fits one data set perfectly. In grounding theory building, there are various phases, namely open coding, axial coding, and selective coding. Open coding is a part of the analysis concerning with identifying, naming, categorizing, and describing phenomena found in the context. Essentially, the text is read in search of the answers to the repeated question. What is this about? What is being referenced here? Axial coding is the process of relating codes, that is categories and properties, to each other via a combination of inductive and deductive thinking. Grounded theorists emphasize causal relationships and fit things into a basic frame of generic relationships. The frame consists of elements such as phenomena, causal conditions. Ethnographic study, a portrait is drawn of a cultural group or people. The researcher needs to have a sound knowledge in the cultural anthropology and also meaning of socio-cultural system as well as the concepts explored by the ethnographers. The time taken for the data collection is extensive, involving prolonged time in the field. In a case study, a specific case is examined. It is exploration of a bounded system, bounded by time and space. Through detailed in-depth data collection, involving multiple sources of information, which are rich in variety. It is holistic in nature and examines a real life situation. Now, another field, that is anthropology. Anthropology is more than any other social or behavioral science. It has resisted simplistic, reductionist explanations of the social phenomena. The holistic perspective encourages anthropologists to consider a wide range of factors while implementing to understand human behavior, biological, social, cultural, psychological, economic, political, ecological, and many others. A fundamental proposition of anthropology is that no part can be fully or even accurately understood apart from the whole. So, the emphasis is on the whole, on the situation as a whole or individual as a whole. So, exploratory research is an early step in the research process used for identifying problems, solutions, and other information needed to prepare for trials of improved practices. It includes in-depth interviews, observations, and also focus group discussions. Consultative research uses interactive information gathering methods for data collection. During consultative research, important scientific information and key cultural and personal concerns are examined, and changes in behaviors are also negotiated. Participatory research and service learning have many common elements. Integrating in academic content and service in the community can bring students a sense of connectedness between, that is, classroom learning and also their personal lives and also lives of others within the larger community. This is what the service learning tends to. Community based participatory research has an iterative process that provides an ongoing engagement between campus and the community in terms of learning as well as the development of skills, capacity, and power. Learning for participants, community members, and students is personal in terms of working closely with the people with whom they would be unlikely to interact. This contributes to building critical and civic consciousness. Now, let us examine the symbolic interaction, basic premise, and also the approach. With symbolic interactionism, reality is seen as a social developed interaction with others. Most of the symbolic integrationists believe a physical reality does indeed exist by an individual's social definitions, and that social definitions do develop in part or in relation to something real. People thus do not respond to this directly, but rather to the social understanding of the reality, that is, respond to this reality indirectly through a kind of filters or eyeglasses, that is, a perspectives. This means that the humans exist not in the physical space composed of the realities, but in the world composed only of objects. According to Blumer, the objects can be divided into three types, that is, physical objects, social objects, and also the abstract objects. Both individuals and society, they cannot be separated far from each other for two reasons. One being that they are both created through social interaction, and two, one cannot understand in terms without the other. Behavior is not defined by forces from the environment or inner forces such as drives or instincts, but rather by a reflective, socially understood meaning of both the internal and external incentives that are currently presented. Then, according to Haber-Blumer, he set out basic premises of the perspective. That is, number one is that humans act towards things on the basis of meanings they ascribe to those things. And number two, the meaning of such things is derived from or arises out of the social interaction that one has with others and the society. And number three, these meanings are handled in and modified through an interpretive process used by the person in dealing with the things he or she encounters. In this context, I would like to discuss with you discussions in a book that is Mind, Self and the Society. Mind, Self and Society is a book that was published by Mead's students based on his lectures and teachings. The title of the book serves as a key to the concepts of symbolic interactionist theory. As discussed in this book, the mind refers to the individual's ability to use symbols to create meanings for the world around him. Individuals use language and thought to accomplish this goal. Self refers to an individual's ability to reflect on the way that he or she is perceived by others. Finally, society, according to Mead, is where all these interactions are taking place. Regarding the I and me, while establishing the idea of self, Mead introduced a distinction between I and the me. Respectively, the active and socialized aspect of the person, the me is a similar concept to Cooley's looking glass self. An example of these concepts is the Pygmalion effect, whereby a person behaves to match the sense of self, that is me, they derive from others in a form of self-fulfilling prophecy. There are five central ideas to symbolic interactionism, according to Joel Meek-Sharon, author of Symbolic Interactionism, An Introduction, An Interpretation, An Interrogation. These are: the human being must be understood as a social person. It is a constant search for the social interaction that leads us to do what we do, instead of focusing on the individual and his or her personality, or on how the society or social situation causes human behavior. Symbolic interactionism focuses on the activities that take place between actors. Interaction is a basic unit of the study. Individuals are created through interaction. Society too is created through social interaction. What we do depends on interaction with others earlier in our lifetimes, and it depends on our interaction right now. Social interaction is central to what we do if we want to understand cause, focus on social interaction. The human being must be understood as a thinking being. Human action is not only interaction among individuals, but also interaction within the individuals. It is not our ideas or attitudes or values that are as important as the constant, active, ongoing process of thinking. We are not simply conditioned. We are not simply beings who are influenced by those around us. We are not simply products of society. We are, to our very core, thinking animals, always conversing with ourselves as we interact with others. If we want to understand cause, focus on human thinking. Humans do not sense their environment directly. Instead, humans define the situation they are in. An environment may actually exist, but it is our definition of it that is important. Definition does not simply randomly happen. Instead, it results from ongoing social interaction and thinking. The cause of human action is a result of what is occurring in our present situation. Cause unfolds in the present social interaction, present thinking, and present definition. It is not society's encounters with us in our past that causes action, nor it is our own past experience that does. It is instead social interaction, thinking, definition of the situation that take place in the present. Our past enters into our actions primarily because we think about it and apply it to the definition of the present situation. Human beings are described as active beings in relation to their environment. Words such as conditioning, responding, controlled, imprisoned, and formed are not used to describe the human being in symbolic interaction. In contrast to other social scientific perspectives, humans are not thought of as being passive in relation to their surroundings, but actively involved in what they do. Let us now examine structuralism. Structuralism is a theoretical paradigm in sociology, anthropology, linguistics, and also semiotics, that the elements of human culture must be understood in terms of their relationships to a larger, overarching system or structure. It works to uncover the structures that underlie all the things that humans do, things perceive and feel. Alternately, as summarized by philosopher Simon Blackburn, structuralism is the belief that phenomena of human life are not intelligible except through their interrelations. These relations constitute of structure, and behind local variations in the surface phenomena, there are constant laws of abstract culture. Structuralism originated in the early 1900s. The structural linguistics of Ferdinand de Saussure and also subsequent Prague, Moscow and Copenhagen schools of linguistics in the late 1950s and early 60s, when structural linguistics was facing serious challenges from the likes of Noam Chomsky and others fading in the importance and array of scholars in the humanities. Borrowed sources, concept for use in the respective fields of study, French anthropologist Claude Lévi-Strauss was arguably the first scholar sparking a widespread interest in structuralism. The structuralist mode of reasoning had been applied in diverse range of fields, including anthropology, sociology, psychology, literary criticism, economics and architecture. The most prominent thinkers associated with structuralism include Lévi-Strauss, linguistic Roman Jakobson, and psychoanalyst Jacques Lacan. As an intellectual movement, structuralism was initially presumed to be the heir apparent to existentialism. However, by the late 1960s, many of the structuralism basic tenets came in under attack from a new wave of predominantly French intellectuals such as philosopher and historian Michel Foucault, the philosopher and the social commentator Jacques Derrida, the Marxist philosopher Louis Althusser, and the literary critic Ronald Barthes. Though elements of their work necessarily relate to structuralism and are informed by it, these theorists have generally been referred to as post-structuralists. In the 1970s, structuralism was criticized for its rigidity and also ahistoricism. Feminism is a collection of movements and ideologies that are aimed at defining, establishing and defending equal political, economical and also cultural and social rights for women. These include seeking to establish equal opportunities for women in education and employment. A feminist advocates or supports the rights and equality of women. Feminist theory, which emerged from feminist movements, aims to understand the nature of gender inequality by examining women's social roles and their life experiences. It has developed theories in a variety of disciplines in order to respond to issues such as the social construction of the sex and gender. Some of the earlier forms of feminism have been criticized for taking into account only white, middle class, educated perspectives. This led to the creation of ethnically specific or multiculturalist forms of feminism. Feminist activist campaigns for women rights, such as in contract law, property and voting, while also promoting bodily integrity, autonomy, reproductive rights for women. Feminist campaigns have changed societies, particularly in the West, by achieving women's suffrage, then also gender neutrality in English, equal pay for women, reproductive rights for women, including access to contraceptives and abortion, and the right to enter into contracts and own property, Feminists have worked to protect women and girls from domestic violence, sexual harassment and sexual assault. They also have advocated for workplace rights, including maternity leave and against forms of discrimination against women. Feminism is mainly focused on women's issue, but author Bell Books and others have argued that since feminism seeks gender equality, it must necessarily include men's liberation, because men are also harmed by the sexism and gender roles. Now, let us see what are the subjects for qualitative research. Qualitative research cannot be conducted through a priori samples only. Sampling may go on throughout research. Various sampling techniques such as following may be employed in the qualitative research. Let us see what they are. That is typical case sampling, intensity sampling, critical case sampling, also sensitive case sampling, then another one is convenience sampling, primary selection and secondary selection. Now, let us see what are the different tools and techniques of qualitative research. Qualitative research cannot be conducted at all through the static tools and techniques. Tools and techniques are very often functions of the field. Theory, in fact, is a product of inquiry. Tools and techniques of qualitative research are innumerous, such as observation, interview, triangulation, focus group discussion, reflective dialogue. Now, let us see what is observation. Observation is a technique of data collection in which one or more persons observe the happenings in a relevant situation on the basis of predetermined scheme. It could be participant observation, in which the observer participates himself in said condition. In non-participant observation, the observer observes the behavior in a real life situation, but he is not participating in it. An interview is a two-person conversation that is initiated by the researcher on content specified by research objectives of systematic description, prediction or explanation. Now, triangulation uses two or more methods to investigate to get a more complete, accurate picture of human behavior. This can be done through convergence of gathering data from different sources through different methods. Focused group discussion are organized group discussions which are focused around a single theme. The group is a purposive sample based on certain predetermined criteria. Statements of one person initiates a chain reaction of comments or responses from other respondents. When a group deliberates over a theme or a problem, many a time there is an excitement among participants to put forward their views. They can also be email facilitated reflective dialogue. They may be used to engage human service practitioners as partners in research about sensitive areas of frontline work, which otherwise can be difficult for a range of reasons, such as time constraints and geographical limitations, trust in the research relationships, issues of privacy, and also fear of professional judgment. Now, there are certain assumptions that underlie qualitative research. There are assumptions are the beliefs which have never been tested nor testable at a given point of time. Very often, the assumptions of a qualitative study are that the respondents would make authentic responses. No testimony is required of their responses. The investigator would make valid observations. Now, regarding the formulation of a qualitative research problem, the steps for formulation of a qualitative research problem are as follows. They are based on certain basic tenets. Number one is identification of a focus of interest or problem. Some of the problems identified are presented as follows. Number one is that a study of the process issues for organizing research and training in distance teacher education, study of a 23-year-old girl having compulsive obsessive neurosis, or another one study is a study of a 5-year-old child having learning difficulties, seemingly due to inattention by parents and teacher and short attention span of the child. Another study is a study of 12-year-old girl having obsessive neurosis. Very often the problem titles are broad, having specification of limited domains and variables. Number two is feasibility of the study. Prior to taking off, the feasibility of the study needs to be examined from various angles, such as technological, procedural, legal, ethical, social, economical. Now, let us examine these studies. That is, the objectives of the studies need to be initiated as specifically and interconnected as possible. The objectives corresponding to the problem stated above could be as follows. Now, number one problem, to study the process issues in organizing research, organizing support services, and developing and using media and materials in distance teacher education. Now, problem two, to diagnose the case, to suggest the prognosis for its disposition. Problem three, to assess the needs of the child and also to devise suitable teaching programs for implementation in individual, small group or class setting, to provide specific advice programs and materials to enable class teacher to consolidate and extend the learning of the child on the case load. Problem 4, to find out the causes of the obsessive neurosis of the child, to suggest remedies for relieving the child of the disease. Then formulation of hypothesis or propositions or research question is the next step. There is no piece of research without any research questions, but hypothesis and propositions emerge only on having thorough understanding of the number and nature of variables related to the problems and their interrelations. And number five is the decision regarding the research types and methods. That is, decision regarding the research types and methods to be employed are guided by the nature of problems. For problem one, both quantitative and qualitative research may be conducted. It may employ status survey method. Problem 2 and 3 and also the 4, they demand more of case study approaches. Regarding the population and samples, for problem 1, all the distance teacher education institutions may constitute the population for the study. One of the distance teacher education institutions may be identified purposively for the purpose of study for process issues in teaching and research. Then the different samples may be identified for naturalistic inquiry. Some a priori and others during process problems, that is 2, 3 and 4 are single case studies. Regarding the tools and techniques, semi-structured interviews may be developed for studying process issues in organizing research, organizing support services and developing and also using media and materials in distance teacher education. For problem 2, it requires study of the girl by a psychologist or a psychiatrist and a social worker. Problem 3 requires observations of the child by the expert, interviews with the child, parents, teachers and also peers. Now, regarding the data analysis, the data could be analyzed for problem 1 through content analysis and frequencies and also percentage responses. The data with respect to problem 3 may be analyzed through increase in attention span. The data with respect to problem 2 may be analyzed through reduction of obsessive neuroses. To conclude, the qualitative research, be it any type, is holistic in nature. It not only cuts across the commonalities, but is inclusive of unique features of each constituent of the phenomena under study. We need to appreciate logical positivism as well as scientific relativism. Empiricism has its own strengths and limitations. There is a reality in this cosmos not obeying scientific laws. There are fields and attribute values which are not amenable to senses. Intuition has its own strength. Grounded theories and thick descriptions require research rigor and research depth. A large number of researchers leave the relationships at linear levels. There is a need to theorize. There are innumerous questions which every researcher needs to focus, such as how do I identify my own professional needs and values, what possibly are the causes, that is active variables, and context, that is background variables, what are the moderating variables and intervening conditions with mediating variables, how do I formulate a research focus, how do I formulate a research approach and justify it, what ethical principles should guide my research, how should I collect data, how do I reduce bias, how do I analyze data, how do I formulate research syntax, how do I build a theory, how do I monitor change, how do I generate professional development through research. Scattered, inconsistent researches take us nowhere. There should be continuity of research area. Research culminating into mathematical equations to the reality is the climax, but social reality is too complex to be represented through mathematical equations. On the other hand, qualitative research demands competent, seasoned, dedicated, empathetic scholars. Nomothetic research, though cutting across the commonalities, has drawbacks. Due to the missing ideographs, all forms and all types of researches together are too limited to understand the social reality. Ethnography has been marginalized for long because it has been subversive to the positivistic and entrenched conceptions of research rigor and its privileged alternative ways of thinking, knowing and viewing the world. Qualitative methods have also resulted from the failure of experimental approaches to answer critical questions asked about the field. Due to enormous unwielding problems, we need to course and recourse through qualitative research in the true sense. Qualitative research methodologies demand open, empathizing, dedicated, competent, faithful, ethical, integrated, and also interdisciplinary personalities. Thank you. Thanks a lot.